Hey, all you junior hires out there. We're going to have a fun day today. I'm really excited. We're going to be going undercover Christmas. You might be thinking, what in the world does undercover Christmas even mean? Well, undercover Christmas is this. There's a whole lot about the Christmas story that I bet you don't know. So we're going to dive into some of those fun facts about the people that were involved in the historical event of Jesus' birth, as recorded in the scripture, right? Sounds super intriguing, exciting. It's kind of a blur of those two words there. Okay, so maybe not yet, but it will. Because by the end of class, I think you're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to have some great conversations. We're going to learn some things I bet you didn't know. I always like that. I think that's kind of fun. So let's get into that. Today, I'm thinking about diving into Jesus's extended family. So why don't we make that the main cue of the day? Oh, yeah. All right, so main cue of the day. Who were Jesus's extended family? And we're going to find some details about them that I bet you didn't know. All right, you ready? Let's go.
Ruth Bible Academy. Christ in the world through you and me. Hey. Ruth Bible Academy. New creation, new identity.
Let's grow.
Oh, yeah. Time to grow. Let's kick off with our declarations, just like we do every single week. Declaration number one. Do you remember what it is? Anybody? Say it out loud if you know it. Nice job. All right, let me put it up there for everybody. Let's say this on three. One, two, three. God had a plan when he created me, and he says it is good. Turn down that music a little bit. I was rocking out. Is that a little better? A little better? You want louder? You want me louder? Got it. How's that? All right. Declaration number one. Got a plan when he created me. He says it good. Let's do declaration number two. Remember this one? Yeah. Oh, nice job. All right, everybody, together on three. One, two, three. God loves me, and he wants to love through me. All right, and the last declaration. Let me hear it. Woo, you are all some scholars. I like it. You've got this thing memorized. Now, let's say it all together. Ready? On three. One, two, three. God knows I love him when I seek out and do what he shows me. This is huge! If we can get these three truths down into our heart, reformatting the way we think about ourselves, where we think about God, the way we see others, it's gonna set us up for an amazing Christian life. All right, but we got our special declaration for this week. Straight out of the Bible. Let's see what it is. Ooh, I like this one from Zechariah 4:10. Zechariah is kind of a fun word to say. All right, let's say this on three. One, two, three. I celebrate. Hang on. Not Zechariah 4:10. Let's just say I celebrate small the beginnings, okay? On three. One, two, three. I celebrate small beginnings. What does that mean? Anybody got any ideas? I like it. Here's how I would say it. Ready? I celebrate small beginnings means when things are just getting started, I can celebrate it. It doesn't have to be the biggest, most amazing thing right off the bat. Let's say I'm learning how to do something. I'm learning to play basketball. And I'm shooting. And it's like clang, 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 clang. And it's not going in. Finally, I get one in. Celebrate that small beginning. It doesn't mean that you're going to take on some NBA basketball player. But it does mean that you're getting better. And so the more you go, shoot some more. Now you get two in a row, celebrate it. You get three in a row, celebrate it, because we're getting better. Now, especially when it comes to being or becoming who God has created you to be. We're talking about that a little bit today. While we're talking about Jesus' extended family, let's get into this heart and mind download time. Oh, yeah. Okay. So let's start with Jesus' uncle. Does anybody know who Jesus' uncle is? Wait. No, you're actually, you're right. Whoa, I just hit my camera there. You're actually right. But before we dive into Jesus' family, I want to start a little earlier than that, and I want to talk about some of the prophecies in the Old Testament that were about Jesus. Then we'll get into Jesus' family, okay? So how many prophecies do you think about Jesus are in the Old Testament? Good guess. That's too low. Whoa, no, way too high. I don't even know if there's that many verses in the Old Testament. All right, let me just tell you. How many prophecies? I forgot to put up the slide. Here we go. There's a guy named J. Barton Payne. He did some research. He did some counting. And he said there's around 574 verses in the Old Testament that were about Jesus. It's kind of like a great movie. What? Pause for a sec. Favorite Christmas movie of all time. What is it? Let me hear it. Yep, I like that one. Elf? I like Elf. Anybody else? Charlie Brown Christmas? Is that a movie? I guess it kind of is. All right. How is that a Christmas movie? All right, anyway. All right, let's keep going. So what are some keys to a great movie? Good story. Cool characters. Yep. There's some good ideas. I can't get to all of them. Yes. Yes. So here's what I wrote down. You got to have a good plot, a good storyline. That was exactly right. No one's going to watch a movie if you're like, this is the 8-hour show of Dr. Snorri Pants and his sleepy time adventures. It's not going to happen. So I also think what makes a great movie is if there's a great secondary plot or secondary issue that the characters are working through while working through the main issue, the main problem, the main thing they're trying to conquer or do or whatever it is. And so that's huge. But one of the best things for me is when there's a good twist. How many of you like twists? Not the ice cream twist. I mean, I like ice cream twists too, but the twist. Yeah, so the best twists are the ones that no one figures out until it happens. And then once that big twist is revealed, people remember all the foreshadowing that happened earlier in the movie. Foreshadowing, just so you know, in case you don't know that term, is where the writer or the film producer puts little elements into the movie that hint at things that are coming up. And if they're not good at it, they do it so obvious that people figure out the whole twist and everything ahead of time. And then it's like, oh, I figured this movie out a long time ago. How many have ever done that? You knew the end of the movie way before the end of the movie, and then you get bored. Yes. Yes. So I'm in the same boat as you. Yes. So who can think of a great example of this, a good twist or some good foreshadowing? Wait. I got to start off with one of my favorites. You ready for this? I love this one.
There is no escape. Don't make me destroy you. Luke, you do not yet realize your importance. You have only begun to discover your power. Join me, and I will complete your training. With our combined strength, we can end this destructive conflict and bring order to the galaxy.
I'll never join you!
If you only knew the power of the dark side, Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough. He told me you killed him.
No. I am your father.
No. It's not true. That's impossible.
Search your feelings. All right, all know right. I got a call.
No!
All right.
No!
That is a great twist! All throughout that movie, there's little hints that Darth Vader might be somebody that Luke might know. Another one. Can you ever think of another good twist? From Star Wars. Sorry. From Star Wars. No, I didn't know that. I didn't think about that one. One of my favorites, too, is when Luke finds out that Leia is his sister. You're like, oh my word, that makes so much sense. But you never would have guessed that before they reveal it in the movie. All right, so another one. What about Spider-Man Homecoming? When Spider-Man figures out that he's been dating the villain's daughter. So fun, so fun. Or wait. Ant-Man 2. I love Ant-Man 2. Ant-Man and the Wasp, okay, yes. All right. So remember how it starts? This is like a twist right off the beginning, just to get you engaged, right? And so they're driving the car. He wakes up. They're chatting away. And all of a sudden, they realize what? Yes! That they are driving in this little matchbox car along the road because they have shrunk. I love it. I love it. So God, let's get back into the Bible. All right, back in the Bible. We could talk about twists all day long. Movies, I like movies. But anyway. God set up the Old Testament in the same way. It's filled with all kinds of foreshadowing that the devil, the Israelites, people didn't figure out ahead of time. But once Jesus defeated the devil, raised from the dead, the disciples, others, even the devil, began to put all the pieces together and figure it out what actually happened. And all of the prophecies in the Old Testament telling what was going to happen. I think it was so evident. So let's look where I'm going to start. I like this. Let's start at the very beginning. Let's do it. Scripture verse. Get your Bibles. Put them on your head. We'll look up this verse, all right? Because I think it's important to see what your Bible says. Now, if you're watching this video recording, pause it. And so that you can catch up with us. Run, go get your Bible on the classes as the Bible. So pause it. Grab your Bible. Everybody else, you ready? I'm going to show you in 3, 2, 1. We're going to Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. New or old? Old Testament. First book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 3, 15. Look it up. If you have to use the table of contents, it'd be kind of weird to find the first book of the Bible. It's probably close to the beginning. Just a guess. All right, Genesis chapter 3, 15. I'm going to read it for you in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, now if you don't have it yet, keep looking it up. It's important to see what your Bible says, even though I'm reading this, okay? Let's do it. And I will cause hostility between you and the woman and between your offspring and her offspring. He will strike your head and you will strike his heel. What's going on right here? Who can help me out? Tell me what's going on. Mm-hmm. Yes, that's exactly right. So it's the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve sinned. Jesus is talking to them. I'm thinking about the scream you probably just heard through the microphone. That would be my 2-year-old daughter. All right. So God is talking, and the snake is who God's talking to right now. And God says this, and it's right off the bat, one of the first things you see God say, other than when he's creating things, right, is foreshadowing, a prophetic word about what is going to happen. So let's tear this about a little bit. Tear it apart. So I will cause hostility between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring. Why is that significant? Any guesses? Her offspring. Yes, that's exactly right. Her offspring, virgin birth. That's what it's pointing towards. Because guess what? At this time in the culture and everything, if you look in like Leviticus or Numbers, I should say Numbers is a better way. They don't say who the mom and the dad are of each child as they're going through the descendants, right? All they do is the son of. They only focus on the guy side. And so for God to say her offspring was kind of awkward in that people didn't think about that. They would think about his offspring. So her offspring would be a little bit unique. All right. So then he doesn't just leave it there. Right about 750 BC, I feel like God gets a little cocky and he just about gives it all away as it gets closer to Jesus' birth. Check this one out. We're going to look this one up too. Oh, yeah. Oh, close your Bibles. Ready? Here's where we're going. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Isaiah 7:14. Look it up. See what your Bible says. It's so important. Now, this one's a little trickier. New Testament or Old Testament? Old Testament, because we're looking at Old Testament prophecies. That should be pretty evident. All right. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. So if you hit, open your Bible, Psalms, you'll have Proverbs. So if you go about the middle, and then go a few books back, it's a bigger book, so you should be able to find it. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. I'm going to show you in 5, 4, 3. All right, you guys are like, no, it's too fast. All right, look it up. Isaiah 7:14. Chapter 7, big number, 14, little number. Isaiah, all right, now I'm going to show you. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. If you haven't found it, look it up anyway. It's important to see what your Bible says. All right, here's what my version says. All right, then, the Lord himself will give you the sign. Look. The virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. He just about gives it away. I mean, about the only thing he didn't say in this prophecy was, and his name will be Jesus, son of Mary, born in Bethlehem, grew up in Nazareth. Or did he? We might discover a little bit more about these prophecies in just a second. But first, I'm wondering, do you think the people of the day when Jesus was alive knew that Joseph probably wasn't his real father? I want to show you something. Check this out. I think this is interesting. John chapter 8, verse 41. There's some hot-headed people talking with Jesus right here. And Jesus is calling them out on some things, and they're getting real upset. And what do they say to Jesus? They replied, "We aren't illegitimate children." Now, a lot of people think, a lot of theologians, fancy word for people who study the Bible and study the cultures of the Bible and all that. And so a lot of them think that people were trying to make fun of Jesus at this point, pointing out that they knew that Joseph wasn't his real dad, and so he must be a son born out of wedlock, an illegitimate child. And back then, that was pretty serious. Nowadays, it's not as serious. It doesn't seem like that's as big of a deal, but back then, that was really bad. They were like really making fun of him with this comment. So what do you think Jesus did? Do you think he's like, that's it, fire from heaven? No. All right, sorry. The elementary teacher side of me just came out. I gotta be cool. Junior hires. That's right. What's up? All right, never mind. You know what he did? He totally ignored it. He just kept right on going, saying what God was saying, doing what God was doing, and ignored those comments and just breezed right over them. So it makes me think, let me say it this way. Have you ever had someone pick out something about you and start making fun of you for it? Maybe it's something that you do. Maybe it's something you say. I used to say sweet action when I really like something. Whoa, sweet action. People would make fun of that. They probably needed to. That's kind of weird. Or maybe it's because your glasses or haircut or clothing or whatever. You know, people don't need to be kind or inventive when they're looking for a way to try and make fun of people, right? They just pick out whatever they can. It's not fun. So what can we learn from Jesus here, right? Well, where was Jesus' focus? Was he focused on defending himself? Nope. Was he focused on proving himself to be something that's awesome? No, he didn't. What did he do? He focused on who? God. Great. That's the key. If there are people that don't like us, guess what? The Bible promises there's going to be people that don't like us, especially as we grow in our relationship with God and begin to step out and do the things that God wants us to do and say the things that he wants us to say. It can make people feel uncomfortable, and they might lash out at you or try to make fun of you or try to make you feel bad or whatever. But where should our focus be? Same as God, or same as Jesus, on God. You know, it really comes down to this. No matter what, the only power they have to hurt us is the power that we give them. Or you can say it like this. Whose opinion whose opinion do we value more? That's better. Is it God's opinion? Or our opinion, God's opinion or other people's opinion. If we recognize that we're valuing anything more than God's opinion, that automatically becomes an invitation for us to know God better. That's really what it comes down to. Anytime we're valuing something or someone, what they're saying, what they're doing, or a thing, an item, more than what God thinks, it's an invitation. It's not to make us feel bad, but the recognition of that is to invite us into a deeper relationship with God. It's God pointing out, hey, this thing matters more to you than me, and so let's deal with that. Let's hang out a little bit more. I want to be your best friend, so let's really do this. All right. Okay, I think that's cool. We got to pick up the pace. Hang on, let me get off this sign. Okay, so we've looked at a few. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. From that we know that the Messiah, the coming king, is from the line of Jesse, who's the father of King David. Say it that way. So we know he's a descendant of King David. Another spot in Isaiah, we learn that he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father. A Prince of Peace makes me think of Handel's Messiah. Never mind, we're not going there. We're not going to sidetrack anymore. Okay, around 700 BC, Micah says this, Micah chapter 5, verse 2, that said he would be born into the tribe of Judah in the town of Bethlehem. And even the writer of Psalms chapter 72, verse 10, gives away that foreign kings would present gifts to him. There is so much detailed in the Old Testament about Jesus' birth. Not only that, but his life, the choices he would make. You know, he'd die on the cross. It is awesome. So, I forgot. 725 about BC. Hosea, he writes that the Messiah would come out of Egypt. wait a sec, does Jesus come out of Egypt? Think about the Christmas story. What happens? He's about 2 years old. Pharaoh, not Pharaoh. Herod sends the wise men to tell him where the Messiah is, right? And when he does, when the wise men don't go back the same way to go report to Herod, they go back a different way. Then Herod sends his army to kill everyone that's 2 years old or younger. And Joseph, Mary, and Jesus, they escape to Egypt, where they live for a few years. So, proves that prophecy right there. It's pretty cool. And there's more from Moses and Daniel and Jeremiah and Zechariah and Malachi and a bunch more. We just don't have time to get into all that. But what I want to do, because I'm really stirred up about how awesome God is right now. I mean, these prophecies are so cool. I want to thank him for his plan for our lives. Did you know, just like God had a plan for every moment of Jesus' life, God has a plan for every moment of your life too. And just like Jesus, he wants to use off to influence and help people come to know God better. And guess who does it? It's him that does it through us. How awesome is that? He's got a plan for us, and then he empowers us to do the whole plan. It really is all in him and by him and for him and to him. I just want to celebrate. I just want to lift Jesus high. And that's the song. I love this song. I heard it on Life Church from Oklahoma City. I think they wrote it. It's really, really good. So if you don't know this song, I want you to try to memorize these words. We're going to do this each time, each week. If you know this, I want you to close your eyes. Either way, set your heart to praise him. All right? It is time to worship. We lift you high.
We lift our hands, pour out our hearts to you, Lord, to you, Lord. We bow our knees, our gifts we bring to you, Lord, to you.
So today for Chan Check, let's ask him how we can lift him high and then listen to see what he has to say. Remember, he doesn't often talk to us through our ears. He speaks to us through the word, speaks to our hearts. Oftentimes for me, it feels like it's a thought that bubbles up from the inside, a thought that I normally wouldn't think myself. I want to encourage you too, if you have a journal or a notebook with you, open that up and get ready to write some things down. If you're not sure if this is from God or not, you know who's a great person to ask? Your parents. Your parents want you to be sensitive to God's voice. They want you to know him so well and so much. And so this is a great opportunity to be able to develop your relationship even with your parents. I know that feels kind of awkward, but guess what? Your parents would love it. They would freak out if you said, hey, I was praying in class today and I felt like maybe this is something God said. I don't know. Can you help me? If they aren't sure, they know other people they can ask, maybe a pastor, maybe another leader in their life. So anyway, we're going to ask him how we can lift him high. Doesn't have to be a long prayer. Literally could just be that short. And then listen to see what he says, okay? Lord, how can we lift you high? All right, keep listening. I know some of you are already hearing stuff. Write those things down. If you're not hearing anything, it's not going to come by trying really hard. It's really just by being at rest. If you didn't hear anything, that doesn't mean that God's not talking. God doesn't play favorites. God isn't silent towards you. But it could mean We just need to get to know his voice better. Now, those of you that think you might have heard something or definitely know that you heard from God, I want you to put a plan together to act on it, whether it's asking your parents after this class, doing or saying the things that he said. It doesn't have to be anything huge. You know what I heard? I asked him, how can I lift him high? I felt like he said, keep doing an excellent job at work and love your family well. That's what he said. So guess what I'm going to try to do? Give my all at work even more than I am already and love my family well even more than I am already. You know who's going to give me the ability to do it? God will. Guess who's going to give you the ability to do the thing that he put on your heart? God will. It's so awesome. Man, this presence of God is so thick right now. I just don't even want to move on, but I know we have to. We've taken way longer talking about the prophecies and all the other fun stuff than I expected. So we really got to go fast. Let's kick through this real quick. And then if you want to rewind the class, do that worship song again, do chat and check again. I want to really encourage you, go for it. Because God loves you. And he loves hanging out with you. All right. Man, it's so good. All right. So, Undercover Christmas said we're going to dive into what? The extended family, right? So, information, integration. We're talking about Uncle Zach. Zacchaeus. Not the wee little man. Zachariah, Jesus' uncle. So when the Bible introduces them, he and his wife, Elizabeth, are already pretty old, right? And they don't have any kids. Now, at this time, some of you may know this. At this time in their culture, having no kids was like advertising that you're cursed. You think that sounds like a bad day, bad week, bad month, bad year. Advertising that you're cursed. Why? Because everything revolved in that culture around family and honor. And so if you didn't have a family, if you didn't have descendants that you're passing on your wisdom, your abilities, your family name even, then you're kind of, in a sense, you're responsible for ending the family tree. It's a lot of pressure. All right. So let's go. Let's keep going. So who knows what Zachariah's job was? Yes, he was a priest. So at the time, what does a priest even mean? Yeah, they worked at the temple. They did the sacrifices. They did a bunch of stuff. So at the time of Zechariah and Jesus, and that, there were 24 divisions of priests who served in the temple on a rotation. Now, the length of that rotation isn't really specified in the Bible, but some post-biblical traditions imply that it was by the week, but it doesn't really even specify it was 1 week or 2 weeks. But it wasn't by the month, all right, or by the year. That'd be a long time. So everyone born of Aaron, remember, that's like Moses' brother, hundreds and hundreds of years before this. And everyone that was born of Aaron was able to be a priest. And so it's thought that there was thousands of priests at this time. And as well, when it was their division to serve, their whole division would go to Jerusalem for that whole rotation and then return home afterwards. They would stay there in the temple. Sorry, this just popped up and it's throwing me off. I might have to watch that again. There we go. So in order, I can't wait. I got to tell you this. So in order to decide who got to do each one of the positions, they did this thing called casting lots. Has anybody heard of casting lots before? Yeah, it's kind of like a game. Yep. It's like drawing the short stick is a great example. Yes, that was a good one. So how they did it back then, you know what? How many want to hear a Israeli guy really teach us about casting lots. I do too. Let's do it.
Could you also explain about what it means to cast lots? I've heard you explain this a couple of years ago. All right. Very simple little thing for you. Each day in the temple, they would cast lots as to which priest would have the duty for a particular thing. It's a way of allowing God to choose who's going to be appointed to a particular task. And when they would, have you ever seen the, you know, a bunch of guys, this farmers do this all the time, where you grab some straws and you have all these straws and we're going to try to figure out who's going to have to go do something that not everybody wants to do. And so you draw straws and whoever gets the short straw, you're the one that got picking, or the long straw or whatever it is.
Who
you know,
said
you,
that?
You draw, it's a way of casting a lot. It's a way of determining amongst a group of people how you can get it. Now, that's a simple farmer's way of casting lot. The Hebrew way, the one that was used in the temple, had to do with your hand. And basically, it worked like this. You've got five fingers, all right? And they're going to line up a group of priests, and then the task is, who is the one, for example, who's the one who's going to present the morning lamb? Who's the one that's going to actually put the lamb up on the altar? Okay, so we're going to decide which priest gets to do that. So I've got all these priests lined up, and they're ready to support the morning service. And so what will happen is either the high priest or the guy that's kind of in charge that morning, he will tell a aide, he will tell him secretly what the number is. And let's, for the sake of discussion, let's say there's six priests there. We need to decide which one's going to do the morning lamb. So he says to his aide, he said, the number is 33. He picks an arbitrary number. And so what happens is the priest now, the moment comes where we're getting to determine who's the lot going to fall on, they're told to present their hand. Now, if he wants the job, if he would like to do that service, guess what he's going to do? He's going to put up all five fingers. Because when the count starts coming past him, he's got like five chances it will fall on him. But let's say you got a guy who comes up and says, no, I really don't want to do that this morning. I'm only going to put one up. You could, it's your decision. You could put one to five fingers up. Sometimes they put up to three, whatever. Now, what you do is you've got all the fingers up and you start at the one end and you start counting fingers. You know, the guy's got five, one, two, three, four, five. Next guy's only got one, six. Go to the next guy. He's got two up, seven, eight. And you just keep counting until you get to the number that you said beforehand, and let's say it was the guy that only had one finger up, and suddenly in the count, that's number 33. Well, then they announce the lot has fallen on you. You're the one who are going to do the service. It's random, and yet at the same time, you can express yourself into it, and it's a way of taking everybody that's qualified to do it. The Lord decided who's gonna be it. You walked in, you stood in a certain position, you held up a certain number of fingers. There's just so many variables that we assign. We say the Lord is the one who chose. The Lord is the one who worked it out. So that's what we call the casting of lots.
You can't hear me, can you? All right, hang on. So, casting lots. That's how they did it. And guess who was picked this particular day? Zachariah was picked. That was a huge honor for him and for his family, even for his village that he lived in. And so, he actually, if you were chosen, you only got to do this once in your life. Once in your life, a whole lifetime. If you ever get to do it. And so this was huge. So now, you guys want to see that video clip I was about to show you? Let's do it.
This honor is for you, Zachariah, and your village.
She's tea a bit out of shame. Like I thought, but no, I'm out of shame. Ulbakir behi holo.
Son, you will call him John.
My life is too old to bear a child.
And he will be the prophet of the Most High, for he will make ready a people prepared for the Lord.
I am an old man.
You will be struck down and not be able to speak, because you believe it not my words.
Elizabeth, what's wrong, Zechariah?
He has seen a vision from God.
All right, so what would you do now that Bible says an angel showed up and talked to him and didn't show that in the video? What would you do if you heard a voice like that or had an angel show up and start telling you things that seemed impossible? I might do that too. That was awesome. All right. So guess what happened soon after that? I was going to do a scripture base. We are out of time. So write this down. Luke chapter 1, verse 24, so you can look it up later. Here's what it says. Soon afterward, his wife, Elizabeth, became pregnant and went into seclusion for 5 months. Now, who remembers who was Elizabeth pregnant with? Yep, John. John who? It's not his last name, but it almost could feel like his last name. Yep, John the Baptist. Yep, and what was John the Baptist's assignment on his life? Ooh, nice job. Impressive. Yes, to prepare the way of the Lord. He prepared the way for Jesus to come, right? And so when did he start doing this? Not the desert. Oh, now you guys are like, I thought it was the desert. We might have to look this up. All right. Well, I'm going to say it's the scriptures. Look it up as fast again if you want. Otherwise, we got to really get going. Luke chapter 1. It's way too loud. Luke chapter 1, verse 39 through 44. Luke 1, 39, 44. All right. I'm just going to have to read it for it because we are running out of time. We only got like 4 minutes left. Now, at this time, Mary arose and hurried to the hill country to a city named Judea, and she entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, her baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and empowered by him. And she exclaimed loudly, "Blessed, worthy to be praised, are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how has it happened to me that the mother of my Lord would come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy." Now, I think this is super interesting. John the Baptist lived his life preparing the way for the Lord, preparing for Jesus. You could even say they began preparing the way for Jesus in the womb before he was born, because let me see if I can pull that up. Is it this one? Nope. This one. What happens in order? Mary's greeting. Elizabeth hears it. John the Baptist leaps within her womb, and then Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and then she was empowered by the Holy Spirit and began prophesying. That is awesome. So go and do. We don't want to go through this class without figuring out how it applies to our life. It's a lot of really cool information, but growing spiritually takes more than just learning a lot of facts. So what can we learn from these things today? I would normally ask you, but we don't have time to talk about it. So here's some things that I've picked out. Ready? It encourages me that we can all know God's assignment for our life. John the Baptist, let me say it this way, was not God's favorite. And if God knew John the Baptist's plan, if God knew Jesus's plan, guess whose plan he also knows? Yours. And so I know that each one of us can know God's plan for our life and begin developing into that person now, just like the people we saw in the Bible. I do not want to put up hesitation and put on my brakes like Zechariah did, and then have to go through some times where you have to live through the consequences of your wrong choices of trying to resist God. What happened to him? He lost his voice. All right, but we don't have time to get into that. So I also picked out from Zechariah's life, when we're serving God and doing what he wants, God gets us where he wants us, even when it seems almost impossible. Like getting into the temple on that specific time, and everything just lines up, right? Elizabeth is pregnant. Mary is pregnant. Mary goes to visit Elizabeth. The whole of order of events really begin with Zechariah going into the temple on that exact date, at that exact time. And God can do the same thing for us as we are serving and living for him. All right, so I'm also curious, what kind of foreshadowing has God put in our lives, in your life? Things that are hinting at his plan for your life. Because I know they're there already. So it could be something that you've gone through. Could be something that has been spoken over you. I wonder if God is already showing you, even through this class, some of the things that he's created you to be and to do and to say. All right, so speaking of things to come, though, we've come to the end of this class. I gotta let you go. Two super fast announcements, things you need to know. Memory verse, memorize it. By the end of this month, you're going to get 100 coins to spend on the website. You can buy some cool things from the store, create your avatar, upgrade that thing. There's a bunch of things you can do. All right, so do that. And then also, if you're enjoying these classes, tell friends. We want to build these things out with as many kids as we can so that we all can grow and we can really start to wreak havoc on the enemy's territory. All right, that is it. I gotta cut it off. It's been a joy having you here today. I gotta let you go. I will see you all later. Bye.